everyone. I'm Gloria Garayua from Made on Netflix, and you are watching FaceTime with Todd Wharton.
So when people win the lotto and ask the question, what would you do with your money? This is usually the answers that you hear.
Buy a car.
First thing I would do is travel.
Pay off all my debt.
I'd buy a really big house for me and my family, I think.
But not my man, Kevin Wood, who's the videographer for FaceTime with Todd Wharton. News 12 actually caught up with him, and let's hear what his answer is.
I always said if I won $20 million, I'm going to witness protection program so no one will find me.
That's the best answer I've ever heard.
We'll be right back with actress Gloria Garayua.
Damn, that's a good answer.
Welcome back to the show, everyone. So my guest tonight is no stranger to TV or film. You've seen her as the maid in Fun with Dick and Jane. You see her on How to Get Away with Murder. She was on the great show called Reckoning that was on Netflix, but now she co-starred in an Emmy-nominated show called Maids that you can watch right now on Netflix. But you know what? Let's take a look at a clip.
Are you going to sit in the dirt hole all night long?
Come on, let's get out.
What's the matter? You look sad, retard.
Monica, Call me Dick.
Why me, Lord?
I don't know why we didn't think of this before. It's such a good idea. But we're sorry we couldn't pay you. I mean, we have no money.
Oh, it's okay. Your phone is very important to me. I would do anything for him if he turned.
To my daughter-in-law, Carolina. She was married to my son, Dante. The man you murdered?
My condolences. Pal carajo con tus condolencias.
What are you doing here?
We're sisters. Asshole.
I don't talk till I see Bonnie.
She didn't answer her phone.
It's the middle of the night.
And this is urgent.
Was he working as an investigator for you?
I killed him. Frank, JFK, and Elvis. What else do you want to know?
I wouldn't say it was normal.
So it was odd that she called you at 8:52 p.m. the night of the fire?
She wanted me to do some research.
And did Keating ask you to do anything else for her that night?
Forgive me if my mind is a little foggy on some of the details.
I'm in a rush.
Wait, if there's a chance we can save Marco's leg, we should at least discuss this some more. That's what he'd want.
He'd want to live. He'd want to have a life.
I know him. He'd want to take the chance.
I will never forgive myself if Marco died because I made a reckless decision.
Whose decision is this?
And does he have a healthcare proxy?
I don't know what that is.
Then when the accident happened, were you on the way to your wedding or on the way back?
We were headed to the wedding.
Marco's parents are the next of kin. They decide.
Casper, baby, come here. The day after I saw him kill my neighbor, this is how I found Casper. A message from Cuchillo not to talk. I never regretted testifying until right now.
If you were brave enough to stand up to Kachi, the LAPD is going to stand up for you.
Thank you.
Please welcome to the show, Gloria Garayua. How you doing, Gloria?
Hey, Todd. Thanks for having me.
Oh, yeah. It's my pleasure. My pleasure. First of all, so far, congratulations on such a great career. I mean, from Grey's Anatomy, American Housewife, I believe, and you have so many other things under your belt and so many great actors and actresses that you work with. And it was kind of cool to be like, wait, that was the maid from Grey's Anatomy, Fun with Dick and Jane.
I
was like, wait, should I say that word, Dick? And you know what? It's a name. I could say it. So,
yes,
but
yeah.
The first thing I do want to talk about was actually a series that I kind of fell in love with, and I know it just went off the air, and I think a lot of people are really surprised about this, which is Reckoning, that was on Netflix. Tell me about your experience on the show, because this was a different take on a lot of roles that you've done.
My experience on the show was fantastic. And honestly, I'm really bummed that there wasn't a season two. Yeah. I prepared for it. We actually shot in Australia. The storyline has nothing to do with Australia. But when I came back, I was already gearing up for my trip to Australia the following year. And like literally everything I did in my life was in preparation for season two, because I'm going back to Australia. Well, that didn't happen, but I had the time of a lifetime. So I was a series regular. I played Detective Sid.
Yep.
Detective Sid was just hardcore badass. Like, she was just so cool. I mean, they asked me if I'd be willing to cut my hair, and I'm like, yes, like, I don't mind a physical change for a character, within reason, right? But a haircut, yeah, no problem.
Yeah.
I love the way she dressed. One of my friends didn't like the way she dressed. Who cares? I played the role. I love the way she dressed. She was just like all about the sneakers. And, you know, most cops will show up to work when you're a detective in a little blazer. You still want to look professional. Mm-hmm. This girl was in jeans, really cool belts with belt buckles and like high top sneakers. I just loved her essence. And she was really good at what she did. But she had a really nice work-life balance, whereas her detective partner was obsessed with this serial killer case.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what the show's about. So if people haven't watched it, it's about a serial killer. It's very dark. But it was so good. And then Sam Trammell was the lead, you know, the guy from True Blood.
Yeah, I was about to say, like, he's amazing in it. You are too. But
thank you.
Heck? I don't understand.
So I don't understand either. I don't know. I don't know the details behind why it didn't do well. But it didn't get a season two. Maybe the storyline was confusing. I didn't think it was confusing, but I'm saying like sometimes storylines can be confusing for test audiences.
Yeah.
I know that when it ended, the serial killer had been discovered. So even my friends were like, well, what's supposed to happen in another season if they discovered the serial killer? But I was like, but that's okay. Cause we found out pretty early on in the season who the serial killer was.
Right.
I feel like the storyline was about my detective partner's obsession with the case.
Yeah.
And their connection. But I don't know. But either way, it was my second detective role. I also played a detective on How to Get Away with Murder.
Mm-hmm, correct.
And what's interesting is if you met me in person, I'm short. And, you know, like I never saw myself as a cop. I mean, God knows I have the attitude of a cop.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm a New Yorker, we have a little bit of a...
Yeah, Bronx has that little background, too, to become a cop. We can hear it.
I always joke with my friends, like, I can't throw a punch. I'm not a physical fighter, but boy, do I have fighting words. And I only use it if I have to, right? Like, if I have to, you know, use my tongue to defend myself, I will. So that's just the New Yorker in me. But anyway, it was a wonderful experience. I was down in Australia for 4 months. And originally when I got hired, I was told you're definitely in 7 episodes. We don't know if you'll be in the last 3. Right. But we still want to keep you down in Australia for the entire filming, just in case. Well, I hit it off with the writer, and I got in the last 3 episodes also. So
yeah, and you had to rough it in Australia. I mean, you know, I mean, it was either going back to the Bronx or just rough it in Australia.
I gotta tell you, Australia surprised me. Like, I didn't know what to expect. First of all, there aren't kangaroos just hanging out in Sydney, but there are these weird birds. And the Australians would call them trash bin birds because they kind of just eat from the trash, but they're not pigeons. They also had pigeons. They had birds that like laughed. I forget what those are called. My Australian fans are going to be like,
I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah, it'll come to me later.
It'll come to me later too. But it's such a funny sound. And I remember I was in the makeup trailer and I said to the makeup girl, Gemma, I was like, oh, is someone like having a good time out there? And she goes, oh, have you never heard a blah, blah, blah bird? Go out there and listen to it. And it's this beautiful bird that sounds like it's laughing.
Is it the wobble wobble bird or something? Wadja wadja bird. The only reason why I'm saying that, come on, we've all seen Crocodile Dundee, and I remember him mentioning a bird that made that laugh, but he was making a sound. The guy's like eating the chicken, and it's like it's a wobble wobble bird that's making that sound.
Can I confess? I just watched Crocodile Dundee for the first time last week because I have a friend from Australia visiting me, and he was like, "You've never seen Crocodile Dundee?" And we watched it. It was good. It was good. It's a romance.
Actually, it's a great film. I mean, I think they could have probably done it out with the second one, and then they did a third one. It's like, okay, guys, we get it.
I had no idea, really.
Yeah, he came to America, and I think the guy from I can't remember his name, but it was pretty. It's one of those movies you watch when you have nothing else to do, and you got Chinese food and some Coca-Cola, you know, and stuff. But yeah, that. I'm so mad that show is off the air. You were great in it, and it had such a great cast, and I loved the darkness of it. And I was surprised too, again, because it was during COVID where everybody's home. So, you know, we're all watching TV, but you know what? Maybe it was, like you said, they found out who the serial killer was. Maybe there was maybe writers had a writer block. They didn't know where to go after that. And they say, yeah. You know what? It was a successful miniseries. Let's just leave it. And maybe we can always revamp it. You never know. But you are in a Emmy nominated series right now.
Yes.
I believe, right? Emmy nominated, which is pretty amazing. That's next up is the Oscars for you. And that is Made. And you play Penny, who seems like a struggling mom in this series, but yeah. There was a scene that I saw that I liked with Alex. And I want to talk about this because one thing that COVID has taught us is humanitarians should be treated like celebrities. And there's so many of us out there, everybody in the world could be a humanitarian. Tell me about this scene where she was in your house, you were struggling, the place looked like it was from like Storage Wars.
Right.
What she did with you. It was great.
So my character was a hoarder.
Yeah.
And in real life, I'm actually the extreme opposite. I'm a minimalist. Okay. Honestly, I'm always purging. So I looked into the psychology of being a hoarder, and there's different levels and different reasons why people hoard. But there's functioning hoarders, right? Mm-hmm. People who hang on to things for emotional reasons, but they can still live their life. It's not like they're negligent of their children, or it's not like they're leaving disgusting food out. They're just people who collect things and keep collecting and never throw out.
Right.
So I started researching, and there's a bunch of shows about hoarders out there. And when I started looking at episodes, I pretty much cried consistently because you feel for these people. Mm-hmm. Many of them know they have a problem, but they can't bring themselves to asking for help.
Yeah.
And it just feels like this unsurmountable mountain of stuff. They don't know where to start. Mm-hmm. And in the case of my character, Penny, there wasn't money to mm-hmm. pay someone. My character was also very, very pregnant. Mm-hmm. I had to wear a 9-month pregnancy suit. That was interesting. Made me think twice about whether I wanted to be a mom or not.
I know. It's like you're walking around like, yeah, I don't like the way I don't fit in the mirror.
There was that. And the behind the scenes stuff, you actually have to ask someone to help you go to the bathroom because it's like a bodysuit. It kind of snaps. Right. In the private parts. So yeah, you can go to the bathroom, but then you have to like put the suit back on. So instead of taking it off, putting it back on, you just get really cozy with the customer.
It's a great way to like, if a guy hits on you from the back and then you turn around and you don't like him, he sees, oh, I'm sorry, just walk away. Perfect rejection mode right there. You don't have to say it in another language. You just turn around and be like, yeah, I'm not in, and they'll just walk. So, ladies, there's a rejection wall right there. Quick and easy.
Oh, my goodness. You're hilarious. So, Penny is a character that I think is a pivotal point in the series. Now, it's a limited series based on a New York Times bestseller, so there'll never be a season 2. It's just one season. But what happens with Margaret Qualley's character, and Margaret was nominated for Outstanding Actress of a Dramatic Limited Series. I think that's the title of it.
She was great. She was great.
She really was. And I only got to work with her for that one episode. And of course, you're not given access to the other scripts. Right. So you don't know what else she has to do in the series. So I just had her that one day that I shot. We shot so much in one day.
Yeah.
And because I was a guest star, episode mm-hmm. 9, but it's a pivotal role because it's what helps her get out of that sequence of domestic violence mm-hmm. and start the next chapter of her life. Now you asked me a question, like, what was it like to have her enter my house? I have to admit, it was really hard. I mean, obviously it's a role. I don't live like that, like a hoarder, but right. letting someone in to mm-hmm. your home, yep. no matter how you live, is very personal, right? Yep. But to have something that you're ashamed of and to have someone walk in and see it, and then you're asking them to go through articles yeah. that mean so much to you and help you make these huge, important decisions as to whether or not to keep it or throw it yeah. away. Margaret was a wonderful scene partner to work with, very vulnerable, very easy. I was able to go into those deep emotional places quite easily with her. And it was just easy to imagine how hard that would be, opening the door and letting in a stranger. But mm-hmm. when you find yourself in a position like Penny did, where she had to move, and she had 3 kids plus 1 on the way, there was mm-hmm. no way she could bring all that stuff with her. And she had to make that decision. It was almost like she was forced into it, which is really hard for any hoarder. Mm-hmm. But Margaret's character went about it very gently with her, as you have to do with people. It's a psychological thing, detaching from stuff. We put so much emotional connection to our things.
Yes, we do. Well, the best part about, I think, about the scene was it touched on a subject that I think a lot of people would argue on both sides. It's so easy to help people. Right. You don't have to give thousands of dollars. Like, even you're from New York, I'm from New York. Like, you can't give every homeless person money because then you become homeless. Right. But once in a while, you know, if it's late at night or whatever, you see somebody cold, it doesn't hurt to get them a sandwich that can cost $5. Right. Mm-hmm. And in this case, this character simply said, hey, let me help you out. Like, I'm a maid trying to put my kids in a home because, you know, having a home and a space to grow up is more important than anything. And that's what her line was to you. And even though you came at her and said, listen, I can't pay you anymore, she's like, no, listen, you're a mom. I'm a mom. I'm here to help you. Because sometimes you give that extra effort of saying, I don't want your money. I just want to know that when I leave this house, that I just made your life better that day. And hopefully make it better for the future. And it's about that offering your hand for nothing in return. And it's a selfless act that every human today can do. And I think that scene was so important.
It was beautiful, it was awesome. That act of service that she committed. And, you know, like I said, since I hadn't seen her dailies or read mm-hmm. the previous scripts, I didn't know what that character had gone through. So when I did finally watch the series, and I finally got to my scene, I knew what she had overcome. Mm-hmm. So to be able to stay in my house a little longer for free and help really mm-hmm. did mean so much to her, for her journey, for me and my journey. And for people that have suffered domestic violence to know that they can break the cycle.
Yeah.
And it's not easy because we return to our habits. We return to what's familiar, mm-hmm. especially when we go out of the zone.
Yep.
Even if, you know, we're getting hurt, we go to pain because pain is familiar.
Yep.
Anyway, it was the way the season ends is actually quite hopeful. You don't have to be a victim of domestic violence to watch the series, but I feel like we've all known someone, whether it's mental or emotional or physical.
Yep.
And what's interesting about it is by watching the series, you learn signs of abuse. So you realize that you may have been a victim of mental violence and not have really been able to articulate why you felt the way you felt.
Mm-hmm.
So it's beautiful on so many levels, specifically the cinematography.
Yep.
Oh my gosh. I mean, the art direction was just so beautiful. And again, yeah. I didn't have access to the script, so I didn't know that stuff was going to happen. I just was pleasantly surprised watching it alongside everyone else. It was one of the biggest hits. I mean, there was a point where it was number one on Netflix, and then it got passed by Squid Games. But that's okay. I'm a fan of Squid Games, so I'm that mad.
I know, I am too, but it's just like, how do we go from a series and Squid Games? Like, really? It's passing us by? But talking about all this, I'm going to take it to another level. We were talking about giving back, and you're also an example and a mentor of the meaning, keep it moving. The reason why I'm saying that is, even though Reckoning didn't happen, right, which we don't know why, you kept it moving, you're booking roles here and there and there, because part of acting is, there's always going to be ups and downs. Until you get to the point where you wake up one day and there's 40 scripts at your door, and you're Liam Neeson or Denzel Washington or Meryl Streep, right? And it's hard to get there. But not only do you keep it moving and your staircase is consistently climbing to the heavens because that's how talented you are, you built another staircase by helping other actors grow as well, that you created something which is called Acting for True Beginners, which is you being a teacher and giving back. Tell me about why you created this in 2005. I think it's awesome.
So I started this, I started Acting for True Beginners last year in 2021. But the thing is, I have been teaching since 2000.
2005, when she was 5 years old.
Right. Yeah. I hate talking about age. And yet when you start throwing out like years, people start putting two and two together.
She was 15.
I was just a child, y'all. I was a prodigy. So yeah, like I started teaching right after I got out of college. And then when I moved to LA, I kept the teaching thing going. Yeah. And my format for teaching had been group environments. And then that transitioned into one-on-one coaching. Somehow word got around that I was good at it. Yeah. And people would hire me to coach them for their auditions. And I didn't talk about it publicly. I didn't necessarily want my acting career and my teaching career to blend. I wanted to keep them separate.
Right.
And I did that for my acting career. I wanted to make sure that people always thought of me as an actress first. But my side hustle, you know, wasn't waitressing or bartending, even though I did those things too. It was teaching. So, you know, if I didn't have an audition that day, I was like, why shouldn't I be coaching, right? Mm-hmm. And I think I became a better actor by teaching, honestly, because yeah. Just the way you break down scripts and communicating these very like ethereal words, you know, mm-hmm. I feel like acting is so not a concrete thing, but you have to be able to talk about it in a way that feels tangible to a student. So I just got better at it, and people just kept coming. And then what ended up happening was I got slammed, very busy. And so that's why I created Acting for True Beginners. I wanted to provide an online course for people to turn to, especially the beginners, because I was, you know, everyone starts somewhere. So at some point, everyone is a beginner. And I often got hit up by beginners, and it was just becoming really unachievable. Like I couldn't give enough hours in the day to help everyone that reached out. And it felt weird turning people away, you know, even though I was grateful for the work and grateful for the good word of mouth that spread about me. So I created this course. I figured, great, you know what? If I ever get that busy that I have to turn people away, here's something that I can turn them to. Mm. So they still have access to me and my style of teaching and the vocabulary that I use. And then I found there was another really amazing thing about it. There are people out there who either might be switching careers or just wanted to dabble in acting, but are too afraid to join a group acting class. This is like the perfect solution, because you can learn from home. And the idea behind the course was to keep it inexpensive enough that people could repeat it enough that they felt comfortable stopping and then joining a group acting class and not feeling like the words that they were learning were confusing. Mm-hmm. And I've actually gotten that feedback from several people, that people who've stuck with the course feel like they can jump into a class and like feel prepped. Yeah. You know, they don't have to sit back and wait for the teacher to pick on them. They can just volunteer because they feel comfortable knowing what comedic timing is. And you know all about that. You're a comedian yourself. Objective, obstacle, cold reads, whatever the vocabulary is in an acting class, which never stops. Even the more advanced you get, you're always repeating the fundamentals. Mm-hmm. So really, that's why I started Acting for True Beginners. And then I also thought it was kind of cool to give it that title, because if I wanted to in the future, I could start acting for advanced actors, intermediate, whatever the case may be, or masterclass in acting. So I just started with that. I wanted to see how I enjoyed it, what the response would be. Response has been good so far. But yeah, my acting career is actually going so well that I haven't been able to do another.
I was about to say, I love the idea. I love how you've been doing it for a long time, you know, even though it was last year, but you've been coaching since. your career just keeps going, and I don't know how you get to find time to do it. And I think everybody will understand that. Listen, this lady is becoming a lead in a lot of films now, and she's earning an Emmy show. There's going to be Oscar talk years ahead, right? When are you going to have time? Now, the one thing I love is that you're learning, as you said, you were acting, because I always tell people, in order to be a great teacher, you have to be a student first, always, because you never know when your student can actually teach you something, whether it, you know, you just don't know. And like you said, timing is huge. And, you know, I do acting, but I'm not a trained actor. Just people bring me on to a lot of stuff because I have a good memory and I can literally hit the button every time. And it's natural. I don't know what that's all about. It's probably because I'm a middle child and I'm a wise ass, so it's very easy for me to just jump in and chime and just, you know, make people laugh. Like I can go from talk to the president to like talk to a cartoon character and I'll be just on it, right? But
it's great that you're comfortable in your own skin to be able to do that.
It's fun, yeah, because at the end of the day, I tell people it's great to be around a lot of known people. But always remember, guys, they're human beings. They laugh like us. They cry like us. They want to hear stories. They go out. They love omelets. They love burgers. So whether you become a celebrity or not, forget that they are human. They do get together with their family. So if you just talk human, you can learn a lot of great things from celebrities. Now, one thing I wanted to ask you about learning, you've worked with so many great people so far in your career. Was this somebody that was just a huge influence on how your career is going right now that you work with over these years? Because, I mean, from, you know, Tia Leoni to Viola Davis, I mean, the list goes on. Like, is this somebody that could be like, this person really showed me how acting should be in a nutshell?
Yes. And it's interesting because these aren't things you talk about. Like, my experiences on set are treasures, and I don't always, you know, disclose them. I just kind of walk away at the end of the day feeling like I did something good and I hopefully learned something. Yeah. I gotta admit, Viola Davis did teach me something. So she taught me to just chill. What I mean by that is we were on set, and of course, she's an amazing crier. Everyone knows that. My character on How to Get Away with Murder was an investigator. And because of the complexity of the storyline, the writers had me interrogate or question every one of that little circle, little by little. And at one point I was like, I think I've interviewed most people, but I haven't interviewed Viola's character. I wonder if they'll write that. Well, they did. And of course I was so excited and nervous to work with her. But when I was on set, you know, she had to be a victim and cry. Mm-hmm. And of course she did, because she's good at that. But in between takes, she was able to just return to normal and just talk to me. And it taught me that in between takes, you can take a breath, just be human, maybe just have a conversation with your scene partner, especially a guest star. You want to put them at ease. I was a recurring guest star, but it was nice to feel comfortable around the lead of the show, this major celebrity. So yeah, she was able to just kind of turn on the waterworks and turn off the waterworks. And I found that very impressive. I don't know that as a crier, when I have to cry on set, I'm not very good at turning it off. I have to kind of stay in it. But she taught me that you can take the pressure off a little bit and know and trust that it'll be there when you need it. I mean, she was in the middle of telling me some story when they said stand by and action. And I thought to myself, is this woman going to like stop talking and start crying? Yeah. And she did. Like within a second or two after action, she kind of just took a breath, composed herself. I don't know what she thought of, but right there, the tears were. And I go, oh, damn. Yeah, that's a pro. Okay. Stay in your character, Gloria. Like it was exciting and a beautiful acting lesson to witness.
Yeah, she's probably sitting there. She probably started crying because she's looking at you like, this girl better not take my role or kill it.
No one could ever take Viola's place.
No, not at all. Not at all.
Yeah.
This has been pretty amazing. Before we go, though, is there anything you're working on right now? I know we sign NDAs. I talk to actors all the time. Is there something you're working on right now that people should know?
Yeah, I don't mind sharing some things with you. So I've been working a lot in voiceovers, which is so exciting because as long as I've been in this career, I have always felt like the voiceover world was the hardest to really crack into. And people have always been quite mysterious and protective of the way in. I'm not quite sure even how I got in. I just, I know that
you
I got
it. You have a voice for it.
Oh, thanks.
It. You have I'm a not... voice for Disney girls. I can hear the cartoon. Yeah.
I've always loved animation. So yeah. I did manage to book Lego Friends about 2 or 3 years ago, and I did several seasons of that. But I finally cracked the video game nut. I don't even know how, but I've booked some video games lately. That I don't know if I can tell you the titles, but I've been dubbing a lot on Netflix, which is so exciting. And let's see, I just accepted a position today. You're the first to hear about it.
All right. Okay, guys, exclusive on FaceTime with Todd Ward. Take it away.
It's not necessarily an acting role. It's actually a teaching position. Nice. I've been wanting to get not stop the privates because I really enjoy them, but I wanted to try to get into higher education teaching. Okay. And I was just offered a position today.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. So cool. It'll just be twice a week working with acting majors. Nice. And maybe I will refrain from the university, but it's somewhere here in California just because I haven't signed my contract. Yes. But I'm excited. So it'll be Tuesdays and Thursdays for the whole semester. And we'll see if they take me on for the full year. So I think I'm on a trial basis at the moment. But, you know, I have my BFA in acting. You don't have to go to college for acting, but I chose to.
Yeah, Long Island University. I see that.
You do your research. Usually to teach at a university, you need a master's, but I have some years of experience and that's an equivalent. So what I discovered is you can teach your level and below, mm-hmm. As long as you have that degree plus life experience. So I'm so excited to work on a syllabus. And
that's awesome. Well, we are excited for you. And seriously, I think this is amazing. Thank you for sharing that. And congratulations on your Emmy part in Maid. That, guys, definitely check it out. It's on Netflix. It's a great series. It's only a one season series, but it's definitely worth it, because if the Emmy Academy thinks it's worth the trophy, then it's worth you guys to definitely follow. And hopefully we could see Reckoning in the future. You never know, but that's another great show. People can, whether watch it on YouTube or anything else. And no, Gloria, thank you for being a guest on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. I had a great time with you today.
Todd, thank you. Likewise, you're a great host. And I can't wait to hang out when I go to New York.
Oh, yeah, we're going to have a good time. So when you come into New York, just call me and we'll get together for lunch.
I'll be there for the holidays for sure.
Sounds good. So, Gloria, thanks for being a guest on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. And I truly enjoyed this interview. I can talk to you for hours. And congratulations on the Emmy-nominated show, Maze, that you co-starred in. Guys, definitely check it out. It's streaming right now on Netflix. And your career, Gloria, it's an amazing career so far. I love the shows you've been on, the movies, all the actors and actresses that you've worked with. And I love, with all your experience, that you constantly are giving back to actors that are growing as well. Because like I said, your staircase just keeps going, but you built another staircase to help those out as well. And that's what more humans should be, because at the end of the day, all of us can be humanitarians if we really want to. And I think you're on that road as well. So again, congratulations on your career so far. We love it. Guys, I hope you enjoyed this interview. Of course, I know I did. But like I always say, if you're not living a passionate life, then whose life are you living? Take care, guys. I'll see you soon.
He is the most interesting man in the world.
I'm not always on YouTube, but when I am, I make sure I'm subscribed to FaceTime with Todd Wharton. Be thirsty, my friends.